The Sony Xperia 1 Mark III is finally here, and being that it has first released in China, I have managed to get my hands on it quite early. That being said, the prices in the top right corner of the screen reflect the current Chinese price, which I have converted into other currencies since global pricing has yet to be announced. The Xperia 1 Mark III is not only Sony's finest flagship smartphone to date, but has arguably the best hardware seen in smartphone history. We're talking about the world's first smartphone to house a 120Hz 4K HDR OLED display, variable telephoto lens, dual phase detection sensor, and 360 degree reality audio through its speakers. Of course, we get the phone in the box as well as a USB Type-C to Type-C cable, and we get the beefed up 30W charging brick in the box, and it can do 30W, of course, and Qi wireless charging, we give or take, I would say about 15W with a slight upgrade, 4,500mAh battery. Putting that aside, let's go ahead and unwrap the star of the show. I have the frosted gray color variant of the phone. This color only comes in the 256GB variant. If you opt for the 512GB variant, you are going to have to settle for either black or purple. The frosted back in the color means, yes, it is frosted, which is pretty much an anti-glare matte back finish, but you can get a case which starts at about $31. Well, it is $31. It is called the Style Cover with Stand, and it came free with my Xperia 1 Mark III. It matches the exact same color. You can get the same matched color for the black and purple variants, and it has a rubbery finish on the inside, nice, soft, and textured. And of course, we do have a kickstand at the back, which looks really, really awesome and should function relatively well, since I'm always looking for my phone kicker here and there when trying to watch a video on YouTube. Peeling that off, of course, and getting to the phone itself. Getting back to that design, I must say it looks very, very similar in terms of dimensions and design compared to its predecessor, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. This time we have a Snapdragon 888 chipset under the hood, which is paired with 12 gigs of LPDDR5 RAM and 256 or 512 gigs of UFS 3.1 storage. Of course, we also have PS4 Remote Play, as well as DualShock 4 compatibility, and we have 5G, Wi-Fi 6, Bluetooth 5.2, and NFC. We have a Gorilla Glass front display and a Gorilla Glass 6 back, which is anti-glare, and sandwiched between the two is an aluminum frame. It is about 8.2mm in thickness, and around the weight of 187.1 grams. It is also worth mentioning that this is IP68 water and dust resistance for up to 1.5 meters for 30 minutes. The Xperia 1 Mark III might not only be all about cameras this time round, but cameras play a pretty big part in the device. We get a 16 millimeter focal length ultrawide sensor, which is 12 megapixels, a 24 millimeter focal length main sensor, which is also 12 megapixels. Then we have the special sensor here, which is actually a periscope telephoto lens, which can variate between 70 to 105 millimeters focal length, fluctuating between an aperture of f2.3 and f2.8, and can go all the way up to 2.9 or 4.4 optical zoom. And then the fourth and final cam, I guess you could pretty much say just a sensor, is a 3D iToF lens at just 0.3 megapixels. Starting from the least to the most in terms of focal length, which is the ultrawide indoors, that isn't too bad. The main one looks pretty great. The 2.9 times optical zoom looks fantastic. 4.4 times just as good. We can go up to 12.5 times zoom, which is the max digital zoom. Doesn't look the best, but when we use the 3D ToF sensor over here and the main sensor, it looks absolutely fantastic. In terms of depth effect, using the 12 megapixel ultrawide outdoors and shifting over to the main sensor, there's a lot of color and detail in all of them, especially within the optical shots, though the 2.9 times zoom looks slightly better than the 4.4, and the 12.5 looks a bit washed out. Moving on to video, we can record 1080p at 60fps using optical image stabilization. It looks pretty fantastic. We can also do 4K at 30fps using the regular camera app over here. You cannot use 60fps when in 4K, but we can use HDR, which looks pretty much like reality. But when we go into the Cinema Pro app, we can get all the way up to 4K 60fps. I just wish this was still in the regular app, and it is cropped down. Well, not really cropped. It's 21:9 aspect ratio via cinema 4K at 60 FPS with optical image stabilization. I must say it looks pretty darn fantastic. Nothing to complain about the cameras so far. We'll get more in depth with the full review, but what about around the phone? Well, on the right side, we have a volume rocker, a power button, which is integrated into the fingerprint sensor, a voice assistant button this time around, and the trusty old textured shutter button. The phone can also support dual SIMs as well as micro SD supports for up to 1 TB. At the bottom, we have a USB 3.1 Type-C port and the first microphone, the second microphone at the top, and alongside that is the 3.5mm high-res audio jack with LDAC. And talking about audio, at the top and bottom front-facing speakers, we do have 360-degree audio, Dolby Atmos, and DSEE, which utilizes artificial intelligence. Getting past all the outer bits of the Xperia, what about the internals? Well, powering on the device for the first time, you can jump straight into English if you do decide to purchase this phone in China like I have. We get a nifty always-on display, which you can now keep always on. The fingerprint sensor has been improved a ton, and this is near stock Android, pretty much as stock as it gets, with a few little tweaks and turns here to make it a little bit more Sony-like. But you can get Google Assistant straight into the phone, as well as all Google apps as soon as you install Google Play services on the Chinese variants of the device, which is great, making it pretty much a global version. Now, software is all well and great, but what about the display? Well, we are treated to a 6.5-inch 21:9 cinema-wide display. It is 4K HDR OLED with a PPI of 643. It has 1 billion colors, a DCI-P3 rating of 100%, HDR10, and BT2020. We have 1,300 nits of max brightness, 120Hz refresh rate, 240Hz touch sampling rates, and 240Hz motion blur reduction. I must say, this is probably the highest spec display I have ever seen in a smartphone to date. The 4K mode is enabled with creator mode to view your display the way that creator intended for it. And of course, we have 120Hz refresh rate, though there is no automatic refresh rate option or adaptive refresh rate. So if you choose 120, it's going to be at 120 all the time, though it does make a huge difference when you're coming up from 60 FPS, or 60Hz, that is. The display looks absolutely fantastic, and it probably is the star of the show, but let's not forget about that incredible camera system, which of course I will be diving extremely deep into with my full review. The phone itself looks absolutely spectacular at the back. I am a huge fan of the frosted gray finish. Make sure to like, subscribe, and smash that notification bell so that you are notified as soon as my full review drops, which should be in the next few days. This is TechNick, and I'll catch you in the next one.